Welcome back, folks. You're still with us. Welcome back to Emerald City Comic Con. And yes, thank you. Thank you. I will pay you later. Thank you. My next guest is a Lambda Literary Award finalist, Prism Comics QPG recipient, creator of the queer superhero Duck.
That's right.
She's drawn Gem and the Holograms for IDW and Silk and Avengers No More Bullying. That was actually your first comic.
It was with Jody that was just here.
I know, that was just, I was like, could we have just had them up here at the same time?
Which we totally planned, you guys.
Yes.
We totally thought about that ahead of time. It was totally planned.
You also worked on Black Panther, Long Live the King with Nnedi Okorafor.
Yes.
Who you're working with on LaGuardia.
Yeah.
And it was really funny because I remember first seeing it. I'm like, wow, it looks like the airport. And I'm like,
it is.
It's named for the airport. There you go.
And spoilers, I don't think it's a super spoiler, but like, even though this happens in the future, LaGuardia is still under construction.
Yes. So, which, if you're from New York, you will find that humorous.
Yeah.
LaGuardia and... I'm convinced LaGuardia, the Midtown Tunnel.
Yep, always. Like,
and Williamsburg
from now
Bridge
until the end of
has
time.
Been under construction since I was born.
Yes, and will continue to be far, far into the future.
Exactly. There's only two seasons in New York, summer and winter and construction. That's basically how it works. So let's talk about LaGuardia a little bit.
Let's.
Now, Nnedi Okorafor obviously is a Hugo Nebula Award winning.
Everything.
Yeah, I mean, she's done some incredible, incredible work.
Binti
is one of my favorite stories.
So LaGuardia, if you're a Binti fan, LaGuardia takes place in the same universe as Binti, but about 100 years before the events in Binti happen.
Oh, wow. I didn't realize that.
Yeah, and so while I was drawing some of the panels, I was listening to Binti, the second book, on audiobook while I'm drawing, and I had this like moment of sort of like meta, you know, art influencing art as I'm making the world that I know she exists in. So even though the two properties are not, you know, quite related, in Nnedi's mind they occupy the same space, which I love.
Now, whose idea was it to make the character look like Nnedi?
Oh my goodness, so this is the thing. She was saying that she gets a lot of people that say, well, Future looks an awful lot like you. And she said that was an invention of the artist, which it was. But Nnedi described the character as a Nigerian-American woman who wears glasses and has very long dreadlocks and like just described herself to me. And so I was like, well, this is an easy place
to start. I was going
to
say, that's not really a stretch. She's kind of describing herself.
Yes. And I think it would be important to say that the difference really between Nnedi and Future is, and Nnedi would say this, that Future runs away from her problems and Nnedi is very much will address them directly. And so I think it's a character difference, but yeah, they look alike.
They do, and it's beautifully, beautifully drawn. And that's what I want to talk to you about.
Yeah.
What is it like working with her? Because I know that she's very descriptive in her prose. So were you getting scripts that were like 300-page tomes?
No, but she does have a very novelistic voice when she's writing comic book scripts, and I think she's sort of getting used to the format. So she comes to comics from novels, and you can, as an artist that has worked with several writers, you can feel that novelistic sensibility. I had to do a lot of, we had worked together over at Marvel, so I wasn't going in cold, and I knew that like her instincts as a novelist weren't the instincts of a comic book writer, so she would want to break the page one panel later than a comic book should break. So there's like a moment of like, who's that coming in the door? And then the page turns and you see who it is, and she would write the script with like, the person is through the door, you know, and like, so there's this sort of balance where I'd always be putting, it seemed, the final panel of one page on the first panel of the next page. But we get there in the end, and it's such a collaborative thing, and she trusts me, and she's brilliant, so we find a way to make it work.
And that's important, too, that you, because it's a push-pull between the writer and the artist. And I always ask this question, like, what's the process like?
Yeah.
Because some people are like, no, I just give them three words and let them do whatever. And then other people are like, yeah, they gave me a manifesto.
She's So it's wonderful. I worked when I was on Silk with Robbie Thompson. He is a writer for Supernatural, so he is used to the format of like writing dialogue and sort of like pacing a comic book in this way. And when it came to like big Marvel fight scenes, he would say, you know, Silk fights Black Cat and there's an uppercut and a roundhouse kick. And in the script, he would say, but Tana, just have fun with it. Like, just go crazy. But there aren't any like fight scenes here. And so it was a different animal. There would be a lot of description of the like, of the environment, the courtyard where Letme lives, of the sort of like background places, of the kind of self-driving cars she was reaching for. But Nnedi is wonderful for providing photo reference for artists. If you guys are writing comics, provide photo reference for your artists. If you have an idea in your
Pinterest
mind.
Pinterest is your friend.
Yes. Yeah, you want a building to look a certain way, send me a screenshot of that building and I will draw it that certain way for you.
See, you just said that, right? On the live, so you're now gonna get Twitter's full of, that's what you did. So you know what, let's back up a little bit for the people who don't know this story, because Let Me Live is actually the name of a sentient plant that's also an alien.
Yes.
Yes.
Yeah.
So we're gonna let's talk about the story a little bit.
Okay.
So elevator pitch. What would you say it is?
So the elevator pitch for LaGuardia is that we are on Earth just after aliens have made contact with Earth and literal alien immigration is legal. But it's only legal in two places on the planet. In Lagos, Nigeria, and in LaGuardia, New York. Those are the two ports of entry. And this is the way that...
So the only way to get in onto the planet...
Yes.
...is through LaGuardia Airport.
Imagine that, guys. Imagine that.
You think the lines are long now.
And so it's so funny because, like, if you guys follow... If you don't follow Nnedi on Twitter and all social media, you should... Because she's really great at posting pictures of insects. And
I was going to say, unless you have arachnophobia like I do.
Yes, which I also have, and which I think she has. But she like is insisting that she should post pictures of all of these adorable spiders. Why? Why do you do this to me?
Exactly. And I'm like, yay.
And so a lot of our aliens are just like large versions of creatures that exist on Earth. But like... as sea creatures or, you know, flowers, different things like that, but there aren't
here. That have cell phones and talk.
Yes, and so, like, I'm drawing lines at LaGuardia, and there's a giant bat person, and there's Tibetan monks, and there's a spider thing, like, scrolling through its Twitter feed, right? Like, that's what it's like in LaGuardia in the future.
But I actually love that, like, amongst all that, there's still a little girl that decides that she's gonna touch Future's hair. I was like, and it's still New York.
And did you notice that she's holding a King Kong doll?
Yes.
It's so intentional, man. This book is full of Easter eggs. If you are the kind of comic fan that loves Easter eggs, they are there for you. Tweet me and I will tell you all of them.
And she'll send you pictures of insects that were being sent from Nnedi.
There are these really cute creatures called sea sheep. Which, Google it, they exist. They're freaking adorable. And they have like little dot faces. I didn't know they existed. And Nnedi was like, these are the aliens that come out of the spaceship. And I was like, yes, they are. Like, change nothing. Send the picture to the colorist so that like all of the glowy bits are the same, but sea sheep.
But I just want to tell you, the way you're drawing this though, it's very believable. You're there in the scene and it's not, Many times the art for things that are aliens, that are futuristic, I don't want to say they're not finished. I just feel like it's drawn to leave a lot to the imagination. You'll just see a tentacle or something.
Yeah.
But you have like fully formed, like waiting online with roller bags.
Yes.
You know.
And I tried very hard to make this future world feel gritty and granular and real. Like, I want you to believe as an audience that you can like reach out and touch these aliens, that they do live among us. And that was really important to me. So I worked really hard on that. Thanks for picking up on it.
And you're welcome. And I think the other thing that's interesting is that we're seeing a future Nigeria that is open to people coming in from all over the world.
Yes.
But then coming, even though LaGuardia, which is in the States, is open to interstellar travel, it's still distinctly different.
Mm-hmm.
Immigration, you know, it's a very harrowing experience, especially they're coming from another country. There's a lot of people who are anti-alien, anti-immigration. It's a good thing this is fiction, right?
Yeah, totally.
And the other thing that's wonderful is that even amongst these serious moments, there's all this humor and levity,
yeah.
And it also comes out through the artwork. Like when her grandmother realizes, like reveals that she knows that
yes.
she's carrying an alien plant,
yes.
and how the plant pops up, and it's like.
And there's that like what moment?
Yes,
oh, I
of
love
both of them.
That.
It, that's great.
Oh, thank you so much. On that page, if you pick up the book, one of the things that I like about the page layout there specifically is there's a moment between Future and her grandmother, and between them in the panels, I have a leaf from Let Me Live who is dying because he's been uprooted and he needs to like be repotted soon or he will die. But Future can't let her grandmother know because it's an alien. There's a dry leaf falling between the two panels in the gutter. And so that, and then you have that comedic moment at the end. And I think it is such a good, like, that's one of the moments where you feel like as an artist, you just nailed the landing. Like I got that moment with those characters together. So look for that in issue one.
The other funny thing is how the aliens name themselves. Like,
yes.
I'm gonna need
yes.
a shirt that says, Let Me Live.
Yes.
I'm just letting you know. This alien calls himself Let Me Live.
He chose it for himself.
Yes, and then the other aliens are called Laundry
yep.
and Payments.
Yep, and Surveillance.
And Surveillance, yeah.
And this was very
intentional. I'm trying to figure out, like, what is she saying?
I know.
And why are they naming themselves my bills?
Yes, and this is the thing. So, like, in the script, Nnedi, you know, had, like, a sidebar, you know, so, like, the action happens on the page, and she's like, a lot of these aliens that are living in the New Hope apartments are naming themselves after things in their everyday life. And she doesn't really describe it any more than that. She just, like, makes that note, this is important, this is why they're named this, and then moves right along. And so... That's the extent of my background, guys.
Well, I want to thank you for hanging out with us. We definitely need
pleasure.
To pick up this comic because it's amazing.
Yeah. On shelves now. Issue 4 just hit shelves this Wednesday.
Yes. So you can definitely buy and binge all 4. But please stick around because up next is Judd Winnick in Sci-Fi Wire's Behind the Panel. And keep streaming, keep tweeting and talking about us using the hashtags ECCC and It's a Fan Thing. Thank you, everybody.